Okay. And I don't know, is this the microphone or is it this one?
We can hear.
Okay, you can hear me good? Okay. If it's possible, I just have a very special request. If it's possible at all to dim the lights just a bit for this portion. It's kind of hard to talk about the night skies if you don't get that kind of effect of the real night. So if it's possible, that'll be great. It won't be for long. That way you won't get scared at night. But thank you very much for allowing me to be here. I really appreciate it. Like I said, I work here for 4 years, so this place is a very, very special place for me. Being here in this capacity is definitely an honor for me. And so I don't take this for granted. I believe very much in what the mission of the district is and everything you guys do. So I'm really, again, thankful for the opportunity to be here. I want to give a quick shout out to a lot of people that have made what we are doing possible. There's just such a long list of people. Even though I'm here representing two particular associations, the amateur astronomer community is actually huge in South Florida. Unfortunately, you don't see many of us during the day because we tend to kind of come out at night. But we have so much support. This past year, we have had the support not just of Broward County parks. We have had the support of Palm Beach ERN. IDA has, International Dark Sky Association has been working very closely with them. The Astronomical Society of the Palm Beaches, which is here supporting it, FAU, National Park Service. We had the honor of meeting Pedro Ramos a few months ago. And then the list goes on, Seminole Tribe. So what we do, we feel is really important, and we're really excited to be here to share with you what goes on at night, and sometimes in the day, too. Very quickly, the astronomy group that I'm with has been around since the mid-60s. If you ever go to Broward County, the Markham Park, there's a park there, in Markham Park, there's an observatory that was put there thanks to somebody who donated, I think it was an astronomy professor from the University of Puerto Rico, donated his Brandon telescope. His last name was Fox, hence why we named the observatory after him. We do a lot of things. We get involved in public outreach in any number of different ways that you can possibly imagine, from the things that we do right at the observatory to schools, planetariums. I mean, we even get calls from hotels asking us to entertain their tourists with the night skies. We work very closely with NASA. We, as many other astronomy clubs that are in South Florida, are part of this network that NASA calls the NASA Night Sky Network. And it's basically a commitment by all these astronomy clubs and other organizations to basically increase the awareness of the importance of astronomy in education, and as well as the importance of space exploration. Besides those things that we do, we obviously offer some kind of unique things to our members. We get the opportunity to go to dark sites when we are able to find them and when the skies cooperate. We use our telescopes, and we do all kinds of really cool things that you'll see some pictures of as we go on. And this list that I mentioned is really, even though it has the, my Astronomy Association listed in there, again, is very similar to what many other groups do in across the United States or in the world. We do very similar things in the capacity as an astronomy club, so we take this very seriously. As I mentioned, we are located in Markham Park, just right next to two levees. And I'll mention as we go on how important those levees are to a lot of the public outreach that we do. This is their, I'm not going to mention all of them. There's a zillion of them. There's actually, this is just in South Florida, some of the big ones that you might have heard of. Most of them have been established and been around for a very long time. The one in Miami-Dade, which is the Central Florida Astronomical, Southern Cross Astronomical Society. They actually do a big star party every year, the winter star party, I believe it's called, that they do in the Florida Keys. And the really cool thing with some of these star parties, as we call them, is we really forget the geographic boundaries. We really all get together and really enjoy, you know, what we all share in common, which is the sky above us. There's many other groups, as I mentioned. We have FAU in here. Eric has done phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal work. If you've never gone to his observatory, you have no excuse. Take your nieces, your kids, take yourselves. He does a phenomenal job there at FAU in Boca Raton, so highly encourage you to go. And again, there's many more groups. The list goes on that. The other group that I'm here representing and that I felt it was important to kind of combine it with this is the International Dark Sky Association. I'm with the Palm Beach chapter, which Brian Buddy, who's over there, is our president. And just a quick background on why the term dark sky. Dark sky, what we actually refer to, what this particular group is for and what it fights for, is to basically improve lighting so that lighting is efficient, so that light is not wasted, and that we don't light up things that don't need to be light up. The birds don't need light. They can find their way around at night. The airplanes, they can get around without our lights. But unfortunately, when we trespass and we go and do more, light up more than what we really need, we hurt not only things such as, you know, this recreational activity that I, you know, that we talked about, amateur astronomy, but we also hurt wildlife, and we actually even hurt our own health. So this is part of what we do in IDA. We educate. Part of the great work they've done is prepare model ordinances to help communities around the world on how to improve their lighting. They do night sky surveys, and we also help preserve, reward those efforts to preserve it. This is an example of something recently, I believe it was this week, we had the managing director out in the Pensacola area helping with a survey of lights in there. And you can probably take a quick guess which are the good and the bad lights in there. And they help to promote good skies. And the reason why I bring this up is because this recent meeting that we had with Big Cypress National Preserve, we're kind of hoping, you know, they have very special skies, and we're kind of hoping to give them an award at some point for the skies they have. Just very quickly, I think most of you know already what astronomy means. Everybody thinks of the stars and planets and so forth. There's a lot of other terms that I use to describe amateur astronomy. Stargazing is one of them. You hear backyard astronomy, sidewalk astronomy, and I don't know what else. What I can tell you what it is not astrology. We don't tell you the future. but this is a term that we typically prefer to use, but I wanted to at least kind of let you know what it means. Our activity is very passive. When we go out in the recreational lands, we really don't do much except sit and look at the sky. I don't know how much more passive it can be. In fact, the moment that somebody turns the light on, we shout, "Turn it off!" So we bring our little red lights and very minimal lighting. So we unfortunately have a very special need. You know, we are a 24/7 operation. We can always predict the sky conditions. So typically when there's a really good night, it's finally clear, they go insane and they just want to get out and take advantage of it because the next day may just be completely clouded out. So it presents definitely a very unique challenge in order to have lands that are accessible to us because it really, for us to really take advantage of the night, we kind of need this 24/7 access. And so I'll mention that a little bit more in the presentation, but so again, just wanted to reiterate in here the things that we do besides daytime as well as nighttime observation of the sky. We have people that spend a lot of hours photographing deep sky images, such as nebulas and galaxies and so forth. Some of them have even been able to videotape, you know, through time lapses, asteroids passing by, you know, near Earth. We also sometimes occasionally make discoveries. It is not, it's actually very typical that sometimes an asteroid or a comet is actually discovered by an amateur astronomer. And I believe in our club there might have been even one that helped in the discovery of a supernova. So we're a very important extension to professional astronomy. There's a lot of other activities in terms of outreach. IDA, for example, this year hosted their first Dark Sky Festival. To their surprise, you know, they originally expected about 300 people, and instead they ended up with close to 1,000 people. And to me, that really highlights one important aspect. People are hungry, hungry for dark skies. They miss them. And kids that never experienced them really want to. And one good example of this, the Boy Scouts of America, you know, if you've ever been a Boy Scouts, they have a special merit badge for astronomy. And one interesting thing that I noted the other day is that the number of kids that have signed up, because a lot of these merit badges, they kind of pick the things that they want to do. And what we actually seen quite a really nice increase of kids that really want to learn more about astronomy. A lot of public outreach. This was actually on the levee, on L35A, out in there next to Markham Park. This is examples of when we do what we call member treks, when we go out to dark sites, and we set up this really cool telescope setup. And what they actually do, in a very simplistic way, is they attach their laptops to these high, you know, very big telescopes, and they capture very long exposures of the night sky. And if you can imagine, a lot of what they photograph are objects that are many, many, many light years away. And in fact, the light that gets, when they finally capture the light, you're talking about light that made it about thousands, few thousands, hundreds of years before it gets to Earth. So it's a very, very faint light. And so they need very long exposure times, which is why on their end, when they go to the public lands to take photography, they really need to be there for several hours in order to be able to capture all of this light. This is, I'm not a deep sky photographer, but I just wanted to give you an example of, you know, the lucky moment that I had at Big Cypress. This was at Kirby's Storer, where I was able to capture a meteor. And this was actually on cloudy skies, believe it or not. This is another one that I caught on US 27. These are some of the events that we have held at Big Cypress. We basically supported the rangers there with their night sky program, and that's been really great. The Milky Way, believe it or not, you can still see the Milky Way, and you really need to go to the Everglades to see it. You definitely cannot see it in the urban environment anymore. Most recently, you might have heard of the comet Ison, Panthers. And we got a chance to use district lands in order to spot the comet. And we had, I think, between the different events, probably close to 500 people that got to see this comet through our telescopes. And that's not counting all the other people that saw it, you know, from all the other astronomy clubs that were active on that. This particular photo is one that I'm proud of because it was my son that took it. And it is, again, it kind of cloudy skies, but this was in Holy Land's WMA, Wildlife Management Area, right? While he was camping out there. And these are, again, some of the examples of when they do deep sky photography out there. Again, it's beyond impressive. These were not taken by the Hubble telescope. They were taken by regular people like you and me. Unfortunately, probably the biggest challenge that we face, you know, unlike some other types of sports, is we depend on good light, or actually lack of light, in order to be able to do this. And this is an example. This is what is called the artificial night sky brightness. and without going through the details of that, was put together. It basically used satellite imagery, and it basically what it shows are the different levels of light pollution in the atmosphere, and it helps to identify the most polluted areas. And as you can see, obviously you're in the West Coast, you got some good spots of good sky. Out here, we're in trouble. But the really important thing to know is that we still do have this area that you see in green and that you see kind of bluish. It's actually still fairly decent dark skies. And those are really the only what we consider still dark skies in Florida. As you will see on the next, this to me is a really important thing to convey to the Water Management District. Within South Florida, it is the South Florida Water Management District that has the most area with dark skies, which is a great opportunity for, you know, to open areas for people to take advantage of these lands. You notice that there are people who come from Central Florida and come down to South Florida because, again, you know, unless you are in the Pensacola area within South Florida, most of the best dark skies are actually in the in the South Florida Water Management District. These are just examples of some of the sites that we often visit. I think that particular slide, I think I have something out of order in there. Sorry about that. I'll go back to that one in a little bit. I think some of them, I know that, for example, on the Kissimmee Prairie Preserve, it is a very common spot for people that do amateur astronomy. There are other areas that sometimes we go to. For example, Billy Swamp Safari, which is obviously some private property, but we've been able to partner with them and, in fact, held our first safari astronomy night about a month or so ago. And this is just examples of some of the sites. I do want to thank the Water Management District. I think over the past few weeks or so, you guys have added stargazing to the recreation banner, and that brought a huge big smile to me. We would love to be able to work with you to see if we can add some more sites to that map. You know, for example, Harrow Campbell, I can tell you, is definitely one of the areas that people really like to go to. And I believe that there's other places as well, so we'll mention that. So in terms of the challenges that we face, obviously the biggest challenge is light pollution. And I kind of equate this to, you know, in order for you to fish, what is the most important thing that you need as a fisherman? You need fish. And what do fish need? Clean water, right? Otherwise they'll die. So it is the same issue. The, you know, in order for us to keep amateur astronomy going and kicking, which, by the way, in case people don't realize, amateur astronomy has been around since mankind started. It's basically one of the oldest recreational activities of humans. And so that is actually in the last 50 years or so has been something that we basically could be in danger if we don't protect this guy. So again, which is kind of highlights why, again, these lands that are in district lands are really, really important to us. There are other things that are obviously outside of the, you know, out of your control. But some of the other things that we do come up that are challenging for us is things such as trying to come up with schedules for events. You know, oftentimes people want to say, well, can you program an activity on a certain day, whatever? Well, we may not have these tight conditions those days. So we often have to provide both an indoor and an outdoor component when we do public outreach. But by far, I think that one of the most prohibiting things that sometimes we get, and it's not just amateur, you know, organized amateur astronomers, but the public in general, is they want to be able to go to these parks that are in nice dark areas, but there's a big sign in the front entrance that says, close after sunset. So it is a challenge that, you know, we hope to talk with you guys and see how, you know, if it's possible to open some areas, you know, so that we can do this important activity. And so that's more or less what I have to say. There's a stillion slides that I had to let go. There is one thing that I'll probably just show you really quick. It's only like, I think, less than 3 minutes. It had nice, it would have had really nice audio, but unfortunately audio didn't come through. But if this goes through, this is a time lapse taken at Harold Campbell. One of our amateur astronomers, Charlie Lilo, prepared this with very wonderful music that unfortunately you cannot hear. But it really, again, highlights the magic of what happens after sunset and why we really need to have access to those lands, not just for organized groups, but, you know, I often think of the parent that bought a telescope for his kid for Christmas and then comes to the realization that he has no clue where to go to see anything. So it is important. So I think that's it. Any questions?
Great job, Diana. Interesting. You had some really nice pictures. Yeah. Any questions?
Mark, I'd just like to say something real
quick. Go ahead, Dan.
Diana, I just wanted to thank you all for coming, and this is great. It's a new addition to our, you know, our nature-based activities, and we welcome ideas for our website. I know we've started out small, but you can get up with, you know, one of us, and we'll try to expand that and some of the information on there. And then also, we've had a couple events at Dupuy. They've been real successful, but we'd be open to, you know, some special events, you know, planning something like that on district land. So just get up with us. But thanks again for coming.
Interesting. Any other questions? All right. Thanks, Diana. All right. Next, we'll have Richard Bissell for the real estate management for South Florida Water Management District.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you very much. That's a tough presentation to follow, to tell you the truth. It's pretty big in scale, and I enjoyed that very much. So good afternoon, everybody.